We have two guests who are joining us in the studio. Andrew Molo is the Group Sales and Marketing Manager at ECTA, ECTA. Is it, what is it? What do you call it? Is it ECTA? Is it ECTA?
ECTA.
Uh-huh. And you'll tell us what ECTA is, mm-hmm. without an N. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then Charles Olo is the Oriel Ngong Branch Manager. He's been here before. Charles, good to have you again.
Thank you.
Karibu sana to Kenya's biggest conversation.
I'm delighted.
Yes. Hiya. CT will welcome you with the day's proverb. So what this guy does is every week he goes across the country and he... not a continent.
Continent. Africa.
Continent. Continenti.
Yes.
Wow, we're going to continent in Africa. And then he settles into one country and brings us proverbs from that. This week we've been in the Republic of...
Malawi.
Uh-huh.
Whose capital is Lilongwe.
Mm-hmm.
This is the final proverb for this week, and okay. the final proverb from the Republic of Malawi.
Okay.
What has gone through the ear has gone right in.
What has gone through the ear has gone right in. Andrew, I want to start with you. What's your interpretation of this proverb?
Wow. I think what has gone through the ear should get to your brain. Mm-hmm. That's my interpretation. You should understand it, appreciate mm-hmm. it, and consume it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Charles?
To me, what has gone through the ear is what you already consumed. And it's only what you can talk about. Yeah.
Mm. It's only what you can make use of. Mm-hmm. Because you've consumed it.
Yeah.
Both interpretations are good. You see, the beauty of asking someone's perspective is mm. you end up telling us things we hadn't thought of.
Yeah. Mm.
And you can't be wrong.
Mm.
Because that is how you see it.
Yes.
Mm. Yes.
Yeah. Mm. All right. So, Andrew, start by telling us what is ECTA.
Yeah. ECTA is a company which has been around for a while.
Mm.
The founder is Sheikh Ameta. The former rally driver.
Shekameta, the famous Shekameta.
The famous Shekameta.
Wow.
He's the founder of ECTA.
Mm-hmm.
We've evolved through very many businesses that we've done before.
Yeah.
But because of the enthusiasm of the founder around motorsport,
mm.
Subaru is one of the franchises that we hold.
Mm.
Over the years, we've increased what we do.
Mm-hmm.
We also currently are a franchise holder for JSE,
mm.
Jack of China.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have Oriel. Aftermarket suspension special company.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So Subaru,
so we have
Jack,
Subaru, Jack,
Oriel,
and Oriel.
Yeah,
and Oriel is a franchise holder for Monroe.
Mm. Mm. And those are the ones that we know.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So it's called ECTA.
ECTA.
Is it an acronym for anything in full or initials for anything?
It was, but now we just call it ECTA.
So now it's just the brand is ECTA. ECTA.
Mm.
And you're big on cars.
We're big on cars, absolutely.
Very good.
Yes.
You were last year, Charles, and we spoke about Oriel and not Oriel Dance. Yes. So it's suspension, yes. and understanding suspension, also offering general service, right?
Yeah.
What is it that people should think about when once they've bought this brand new Subaru or second-hand Subaru, and they're thinking, barabara, I need to test. Lazima hii gari jue barabara. Before they do that, before they say, wacha hii gari tuiguzisha barabara, what should they think of?
Always, when people are thinking of buying cars,
mm.
you know, people don't, suspension system
mm.
never come to the minds of the people.
Yeah.
It's just always about the horsepower,
mm.
the color of the car, the comfort that you are going to get, but you will find that almost 70% of the safety that people enjoy from the vehicle is derived from the suspension.
Mm-hmm.
So we always advise people that once you buy the car, especially if they're the gray imports,
yeah.
it is good to take it for inspection
mm.
and find out whether the shock absorbers or the coil springs are okay and are complying to our local road conditions.
Mm.
Our parts or our suspensions are tropicalized for our local roads,
mm.
and most of the time you'll find that whatever that we fit it as original equipment replacement,
mm.
but something that will give you firmer grip, but maintain comfort, stability, the safety that we need.
Charles, what is a suspension of a vehicle?
A suspension comprises several components on a car.
Mm.
Under suspension, we have shocks, we have springs, we have bushes, tie rod ends, even tires are part of suspension and even the braking system. So it is almost 90% of underneath.
It's like anything that you find underneath the entire car.
It is the whole thing.
The only thing you've learned is the engine.
Yeah. The only thing is just
the door.
And the body.
And the color.
And the color.
And the color. So we are seeing the uptake of e-vehicles, electric vehicles in the country.
Mm-hmm.
How has Jack performed in the country so far, in the market?
Okay. I think I can say we are pioneers in terms of EV in Kenya, and more so, most of our competition probably offer what I would call small cars, small SUV EV. For us, we've come in with a utilitarian offer in terms of a double cab, and we also have trucks as well. So we positioned ourselves differently in terms of being able to target probably where the use and the carbon emissions are probably higher than would be, so that the impact on the environment will be significant. So our positioning is to make sure that those people who use their vehicles more often, who have a bigger environmental impact, have access to EV. So you find that a lot of companies, construction firms, use a lot of double cabs for their work, for their engineers and other people. And they do a lot of mileage. So we're in that segment, and also small trucks as well. So we've been able to get a good tracking on the ground on the same. Of course, the challenge remains the charging infrastructure, as it were.
What's that challenge?
The challenge is that there's limited public infrastructure in place. The same way when you drive an internal combustion engine, you have petrol stations everywhere, so you don't need to worry about it. Because of lack of infrastructure on the charging side, it creates a lot of range anxiety, so to speak, and then people are like, can I take this? How will I charge it? That's the challenge is. Currently, most of our customers are corporates, and we're able to install the charging system within their premises, but still, when they go outside, what happens? So that's the main challenge that there is at the moment.
Because the main reason they bought is so the vehicles can then go to the field with the engineers, like you said, right? So when they're out there in the field, then who handles this? But then the question comes into, even if you look at the internal combustion engines and the development of petrol stations and outlets across the country, that was not the job of the motor vehicle companies. It's not the vehicle companies that have invested in this. It's not government that has invested in petrol stations. It is the private sector that's invested in petrol stations. Are we saying that we are not seeing private sector actually coming up to say, I am setting up a charging station?
I think it's already happening. We have an association, IMAC, which we are all having these conversations in terms of how to facilitate adoption of EV. And currently there's a paper being done which will be presented to government to enhance, because there's no quite regulatory framework, as it were. If you do a public charging portal or system in place, how do you charge? IPRA has been grappling with that. They came with some guidelines, not firmed up yet. So I think things are at infancy stage, but I think in the next 1 year we'll have a lot of things coming together to make sure that we have a support system that that'll be able to support the EV. It takes a bit of time in terms of organic evolution of things, but I think now that also the president is very keen on EV, a lot of effort is being done both from the government and the private sector to ensure uptake. Most businesses will quickly take up an opportunity when they see sizable volume. So since now the numbers are not that much, you'll find most entrepreneurs like, do I go in, do I not? So people are still in that wait and see kind of situation. But there's some early adopters who are already in place, but I believe in the next 1 year to 2 years there'll be a rapid acceleration of the same.
Does it make business sense? I mean, you've been in the oil marketing industry for a while. I know you from that side. Does it make business sense for somebody to say, I want to look at how I can start investing in a chain of EV charging centers?
Yes, it would be if you're strategic. Just like going back to my petroleum years, where are you going to position your station? If somebody wants a tip from me, then I think it will be on the key towns, because most of the range of the EVs are between 200 to 350 or thereabout, which means most EV vehicles you cannot drive from here to Mombasa. So mtito one day Voi is a killer in terms of going forward. And of course the big towns as it were. So I think somebody has to be strategic, know who has the EV vehicles, what are their routes, and then you'll be able to implant the same. However, Total Energies I think is doing something the same. So a lot of the traditional fuel companies are already coming on board because they have seen that in Europe and the US, so they're already coming on board to offer the same. So I believe very soon there'll be synergy between the fossil fuel stations and the charging stations, which will be good because now you don't need to develop a complete new infrastructure to support the EV.
You've actually dovetailed into the question I was going to ask next. I mean, why can't oil companies that already have the investment, you have bought the land, you have the licenses, you have everything, you are close to a road, you have customers, why can't they set up just like a corner that's just called an EV charging facility?
Yes, if they can set up a corner where they're selling tires, surely.
Absolutely. I think for them it will be better because also in terms of your cost of overheads, even as the volume and the takeoff is low, you still have your fossil fuel, your tire change centers and your other chains supporting your cost. So over time, I think it's an easier entry for them if you say so. The other one also I would say is KEPS, because we do parking, because a lot of time they have a lot of space as well, and the EV infrastructure doesn't take much space. And the airport, supermarket, parking bays and all that is a good place. So as I shop, I can be charging. When I'm done my shopping after an hour, I have some juice in my car and I move on. So I think it's a good opportunity as well.
Yeah, because they are now investing in parking lots and charging as an arm and a leg. They can charge us as we charge our vehicles.
Absolutely.
Okay. Absolutely. Subaru. Now, what's the proper pronunciation of this? There are people who say Subaru, they say it's a Subaru. What is it?
I always give latitude, depending on which school you went to.
Whatever floats your boat.
So Subaru, Subaru. So Kenyans have all sorts of connotations of the same.
It's become a popular model in the market. Why do you think this is so?
Reliability is one thing. Safety is one thing we are big on. We moved a notch higher in terms of safety with EyeSight technology that is now in our vehicles.
Sorry, repeat that again.
EyeSight.
You'll explain it, won't you?
I'll explain it.
The car can see.
The car can see. It helps you drive. And then, of course, the four-wheel drive capability that in all our vehicles, as it were. So that gives you a little bit, especially now with this rain, you know you'll go through it. Absolutely.
So explain EyeSight.
EyeSight technology is that the vehicle is fitted with cameras that will help you see what's in front of you. So if it detects an obstruction, instant one, that you may not have picked, it will break the car. It will apply the brakes. It will warn you. For example, we have what we call adaptive cruise control. When you engage the adaptive cruise control, the vehicle goes at 100 kilometers per hour, for example. If the guy in front of you, you approach him, he's doing 90 and you're close to him, the car will decelerate to exactly 90 of the guy in front of you. You will check to overtake. If it sees an obstacle, it will warn you, it will give you lighting. Then you can overtake. Then once you overtake again, it goes back to 100 kilometers per hour.
Too much technology, good, but also at the same time, it can get noisy, can't it? Especially when you're, you know, driving and you're close to objects. So you are parking in this country. Kuna kabush hapa, kuna ukuta pandei.
Kuna bodaboda.
Kuna bodaboda. Does it? Do people complain about this?
I think once you master, for me, what I always tell my advice our customers that it would be very difficult to use it in our traffic condition because we don't know how to keep good distances between ourselves. We always bumper to bumper in this country as it were. However, when you're enjoying your ride to Narok and the road is bliss, please engage your EyeSight and enjoy.
You follow with it.
Absolutely.
City, did you get to completely understand why all those things on the underside of a motor vehicle are considered suspension?
No. I've heard the word suspension and what Charles described makes sense. I understand it, but why is it referred to as suspension?
Okay, suspension. Suspension. We call it a suspension system because it's a combination of several components working in hand in support of the car safety and stability. So that's why I said that it combines things to do with the bushes. If one of these things, one of these components are defective, it affects the rest.
Would it also apply to situation, because everything you describe in combination holds the car from the ground, so it suspends the car from the ground?
Yes.
The idea basically is to suspend you and ensure that you're comfortable. Mm. So all the minor imperfections in the road should be able to be absorbed by the suspension system.
Mm.
When you harshly brake, you're able to make sure that you are not overly tilting when cornering and all that. So it keeps you in a steady position, it suspends you, so to speak.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's why it works in combination with your braking system, with your springs, your tires, all those things come into effect in your suspension.
Mm.
Yeah.
About this, what do you call the eyesight thing?
Eyesight.
Mm. Why do you think it's important?
Why it's important is that always when you're driving, you may not be able to see all that is coming in your way at some point. Sometimes you may be distracted. As nowadays, most of us tend to be distracted. You are thinking too much about the economy, about things, and your senses are not all engaged.
Mm.
But the car's senses are all engaged. So it will beep and warn you. And if there's no reaction from your side, it will take over from you and break the car, just to save your life, as it were. So it's basically to assist you, but not to drive the car for you. It's basically to enhance your senses, so to speak. So like, for example, you're driving and probably not looking at your rear view mirror, and somebody's harshly approaching you from the rear. It will notify you that there is a fast approaching object from the rear, so that you are taking what to do.
Mm. Yeah. I've actually seen where it would be useful.
Yeah.
In a fog.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Where there's low visibility,
you can barely see beyond the bonnet of the car.
Yeah,
if that system will see for you and it will brake appropriately.
Mm-hmm.
Can those eyes of the Subaru see in the fog?
Ours are camera.
Uh-huh.
You use both radar and camera. It's a combination, so it'll perform better than you can do, as it were. Because sometimes you realize in the fog, most of us in driving in the fog, sometimes we tend to put the beam high. When you put it high, it reflects back.
You see even less.
So a lot of us don't know the technology, the technique behind it.
Mm.
And then a lot of people who fit probably what you call bulbs or lighting system in our cars after you bought the car from the showroom,
mm,
don't quite realize that the fog lights at the bottom ideally should not be brilliant white.
Mm.
You see? It should be warm and they see better. They have a better range than the white one. The white one reflects back.
Mm.
So a lot of things happen in this market, and you see a lot, like now you can see in the when you drive on the roads at night, people have all these very bright LED lights that blind everybody else in the process. So when they go into a fog again, they put all those things that just reflects back and even makes their vision even worse.
They don't actually see much.
Exactly. That's why. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They don't see much and affect everybody else and in the process.
They chomp everybody else.
Mm.
It's important when you buy a motor vehicle to constantly now think about how to maintain that motor vehicle and the importance of knowing your service cycles and what to look out for. And many people don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You just know, okay, 10,000 kilometers or 5,000 kilometers, time for service.
Mm-hmm.
That's the basic that they know. And I want to come back to you, Charles. Mm-hmm. Is that all that we should know?
Actually, this week I just had a client that just bought a Subaru BS9.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like he was in a gangsta position. He didn't know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to go to the gray market to service his car. Then I just had a discussion with him, and I told him that you need to know the service history of your car. And since you imported this car from Japan and you don't know the history, you need to start it here. And now you have to do the oil change, the CVT, the brake pads, and even the spark plugs.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, you will have known that I started doing this at this mileage.
Mm.
So that it can help you change do your services on time, the minor service, the intermediate, and even the major services. So it is very important to know when to do service. And while doing services, there are different types of oil that people use, like CVTs and minerals.
Mm.
And you'll find that locally, you will be told that if you do mineral service with with high torque oil, the car can, you can even do it after every 10,000 kilometers. I don't think whether it applies well in this kind of road conditions. Mm. Sometimes it is just good to be honest with customers and tell them that these are different road condition or the different environment from what you can get from those developed countries. So I would always still vouch for a 5,000 kilometer service or maybe 7,000 kilometers. For example, if I go to Kisumu today and it is during dry season, there's a lot of dust on the road.
Yeah.
Sometimes there are no roads. I have to drive off-road.
Yes.
And the car is consuming all those dust and whatever. It is hard to wait until the car covers 10,000 kilometers.
So those three different types of service, right? There is minor, intermediate, major.
Yeah.
What are they? What should happen in each of them?
Minor service just involves the change of oil filter, air filter, and the change of oil. It's just basic.
This one should not cost you much.
That's something that most of the people offered a very minimal rate.
Okay.
And then intermediate now involves even some things to do with bushes. Now it involves a deeper, further inspection to get to know whether you need even diff oil, you need to change bushes, you need to change rackets, you inspect even the condition of the shocks.
So this one, intermediary, is the intermediate one, is you're doing a lot of the checks as well.
Yes,
right?
A lot of the checks.
This one where the car has to go, it's raised, and it goes into that bay where there's a guy under.
Check the tags.
Okay.
Yeah. Get some information from the car owner. And now when it gets to service, that is now deep. It is comprehensive because it might even involve even engine check. Engine service, changing other things rather than just spark plugs, rather than brake pads and whatever. It involves even changing tires and the rest.
After how many kilometers should one do the major service? If I've been doing 5,000 religiously, I do 5,000 for the minor, then after I've done the minor today at 5,000, when should I do the major? Can I do like many minors and then I don't have to do the major?
The major service is supposed to be there after every four minor services. That is 20,000 kilometers. To some, it can be 30,000 kilometers.
What's the importance of this, Sandro?
That is generic. But when you buy a Subaru, for example, or you buy a JSE, we've got a very clear format which we give our customers on when they should come for service. And for each session that you come, you have got a clear checklist of what you're going to look at.
Right.
And if you drive within acceptable parameters, I'm saying that very carefully because Kenyans, for example, you drive within acceptable parameters, your brake pads should ideally do at least 25,000.
Yeah.
But if you drive this and put drive, then it does 10. So we've got a checklist in terms of after how many kilometers, we can give you a projection of what your cost will be of owning the vehicle for the next 5 years, going by the acceptable parameters I tour. So if you operate within those parameters, we can accurately determine to you what your cost of ownership would be. Because there are certain mileages at which you replace certain things without a doubt. So now if you have that coming through our workshops, we keep a log of what you've done before. There are checks that we do and we advise you that this you need to change. This is most likely to come up in the next service. So prepare, it'll cost you about this much. So that we organize our customers, don't cut them in surprises, as it were.
Yeah. Then you guys are going to tell me the spare parts more expensive than the other guy in the other areas. Why should I come to you for the expensive spare part?
Absolutely, our spare parts are not expensive. One, it's genuine. And number two, for Subaru, I can proudly boast that more than half of major dealers in this country actually source through us. So on Subaru parts, you tend to find more genuine parts in the market. And the price variation will not be too different from what I would sell to you. Yeah, unless you're getting a fake, as it were. And then also, I think credit to KRA, they have done a very good job in terms of our ports of entry. So anybody else who brings parallel importation will probably pay the right taxes like I do. what used to happen before is that you find established people pay taxes, some other guys use Chirochiro Road, so you find their costs is lower. Mm. But I think of late, a lot of that has slowed down, and you've seen a lot of compliance. And if you look at the market in terms of genuine parts, then you'll find that the price variation is not as big as it were. Then I also give you warranty with mine.
Warranty?
Absolutely.
For how long?
It depends on the part that you buy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What's the lowest warranty that you give?
It depends on the part. Some have consumables, which may not be quite
all right. Give a blanket statement and say, this is the lowest we can go on any product. This is the highest we can go on any product.
No, that's a dangerous statement, because...
It actually isn't dangerous. You know why?
Okay, you, for example...
Mm-hmm. Yes. On the shocks we can give.
Shocks we give 1 year, mm-hmm. 20,000 kilometers, whichever comes first.
Shock, mm-hmm. 1 year.
Yeah.
1 year.
Yeah, 1 year or 20,000 kilometers, whichever springs. Comes first. Springs, we don't give warranties. Springs, we guarantee you that it will work, and we give even up to 5 years. And that guarantee, it covers the breakage or maybe dissatisfaction. So on shocks, the warranty covers specific areas, mm-hmm. like manufacturing defect. It covers maybe if there can be a noise that coming from the shock, or it is a manufacturing defect, noise, or any leakage that comes in prematurely. Yes.
You have to add the prematurely bit there.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, something that is always, I've always found it interesting and peculiar is this. You buy a car and you're never quite sure what sort of tires to have on your car. Should you have one where you have a rim that offers you a low profile, a high profile, and then again, when it comes to the make, what we look at as lay people and say, like grip, what exactly am I looking for and what is ideal? Since we're talking about a car that we all know, what should I be looking for?
I think all cars manufacturers give a recommendation of the tires that you should have.
They do.
Including tire pressure, absolutely. The unfortunate bit is that a lot of cars that we buy are ex-Japan, then the manual comes in Japanese, and then you don't read it. Unfortunately.
So you don't get to know.
So you don't get to know.
You just look at it.
And then a lot of times people have misconceptions.
Mm.
Like, for example, you see somebody has bought a 4x4, a big SUV. I don't want to mention names.
Mm.
And you go to a tire seller and sells you an off-road tire.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it looks good on that vehicle, but where do you use it? Then you find that you are 90%, 99.9% you're on tarmac.
Yeah.
That tire will wear faster than you'd imagine, because the wrong application. So one vehicle may have two sets of tires, depending on where you want to use it. And that's why you find in Europe, when it comes to winter, they put winter tires. When it comes to summer, they have summer tires. So in Kenya, we don't have that luxury. Kukinua nguo ni same to our cars. So you have the same tire throughout. We are lucky that our weather is not so, our weather is more or less stable. But still, where do you use it? If you are on road all the time, buy on-road tires. The size of the tire will always be in your manual. Will always be indicated.
Even if you
cannot read the Japanese, just go to the internet and log in, and you'll find the recommended size tire that you should have. But whether off-road or on-road depends now on application. Where are you going to drive your car?
What determines the pressure that you put on your tires?
Application as well. And every car has it written either on the seat belt or on the tire, on the whatever. It's always there.
On the seat belt.
On the flip where you open the side of the car, or some on
the flip for fuel.
Mm.
So depending on the manufacturer where it's put, but it's always there. And then you find some manufacturers indicate if the car is fully loaded, put this pressure. If it's this loaded, reduce this pressure. So they're always pressure depending on the load that you're carrying at any one time.
And even the distance of which you are going, because sometimes if you are going for a long distance, you cannot put the same pressure that you are putting while you are driving in town.
Why?
The tire heats up, and then the pressure builds up.
Yeah.
Okay, so for instance, if I'm driving from Mombasa, and I'm coming to Nairobi, low held altitude.
Mm-hmm.
So when I get to some place, should I then reduce the pressure?
If you are coming up, yes, you should. Ideally, you should. But you know, we like just rolling it off.
Is the car heating up because of, you know, just the continuous
friction
use,
rolling on the road? Yes,
the revolution,
not necessarily the altitude.
No, no, but there are two issues.
Uh-huh.
If you change altitude at Mombasa, the atmospheric pressure is higher.
Yeah. Huh?
So what is that? What is 2 bars will be 2.2 bars in Nairobi, for example. So that's why when people drive from Mombasa, you hear the tire burst. The heat, the friction, and the change in atmospheric pressure. So you have all those factors playing in. So there's a bit of science in the way you use your car, as it were.
So how can one tell all these things?
We can guide you.
So you're driving out from here, you want to go to Merile.
If you're leaving Mombasa to Nairobi,
right?
What you can do is basically put slightly less pressure, because as you come up, the atmospheric pressure reduces, the tire gets hotter.
Mm-hmm. And the pressure within the tire will increase.
It will increase automatically. So as you get on, you come to right balance.
Mm-hmm.
But the tires have a good range of endurance.
Mm-hmm.
So rarely will you have a tire burst.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not encouraging misuse.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of us like putting it on the upper limit. That's the problem. So when you go a little bit over the heat and the pressure, then you have
it expands.
The other thing about tires, also tires have expiry dates. Most Kenyans are not aware. So
when Ikiisha.
So there's a time lapse in the tire where the compounds that are made makes the tire also changes. Yeah.
Okay.
So you have a tire, some have a 5-year lifespan, some have 9, some have 10. So you can check the expiry date. It'll be a year manufacture and the expiry date on the tire. So you can buy a tire today which has actually expired.
True. It's brand new, but it has expired.
Yeah, because it's been in stock somewhere for too long and nobody sold it, and most Kenyans are not aware that tires expire.
Tires have a sell by date.
Yes.
Yes.
You're saying most Kenyans. I am one of those most
tires have kama maziwa na mkate.
Absolutely.
So how do you check?
It's indicated on the tire.
It is indicated.
Manufacture and expiry.
On the tire?
On the tire.
Okay.
So they have self-life.
Okay.
Yeah. Just like anything manufactured of compounds, over time it changes. So it goes over a certain time, then its elasticity and its ability to absorb various forces decreases.
Okay.
So it's a new tire, yes. You put a new tire. And you wonder, I had a new tire, but the tire busted. Then you check the tire expired 2 years ago.
Okay, so it doesn't even matter also the usage. So that could
that's one factor again. That's you one check. Factor. So when you're buying a tire, always check when was it manufactured, when's the expiry date, before you pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
Then now what pressure and application, which roads are you on, how are you driving, and all those things come into play. So when you buy a tire, please just check your manufacture and expiry.
Okay.
Get that right first. Then get the tire pressure right, then get the application right, then you're good to go.
In this country, we talked about headlights. Because your tire, it has changed. What causes this? And then what do you do? Is it specific to cars, or is it specific to the type of lamp that you bought, or is it again an issue of age?
It's weathering. Over time, the sun hits it, it gets oxidized, then the composition changes. The old cars, the old technology had glass lenses. Glass is more enduring than plastic. So when you have plastic with all this working on it, then you realize it changes, it becomes yellowish, and it does not emit the right light. So it needs to be polished a bit and all that kind of thing. So it's just a change of material of what we had. If you look at the cars that were built in the 70s and 80s, the lenses were actually glass. They would actually break. Now we have them as plastic. As to our plastic has got its limitations. It is less hazardous in terms of cutting people and everything else, but on the other side, it gets oxidized and suffer all those environmental degradation, as it were.
You know, one of the things that I've always found interesting, again, about cars, is what it is that I expect from a car and what it is that I receive. Essentially, what I expect is brought about by what I am told this car can do. Okay? And that comes the marketing and the hype that goes with it.
Absolutely.
In this country, does one have recourse for a returning your vehicle when those two don't match?
I think the biggest drawback we have in this country, my perception, I take that as a personal perception, is that we take cars as a status thing.
Is it not?
Rather than application.
Is it not a status thing?
Our perception, yes it is, but application is crucial.
It's actually not our perception, it's our reality.
okay, our reality, it's a status.
That if I'm driving a Volkswagen Beetle, mm-hmm. and you're driving
old or new,
old, uh-huh. and you're driving a G-Wagon,
status, of course, is the same. Different. But now, how do you apply it? Mm-hmm. Status is different. Status, yes, I have a G-Wagon, I feel sweet, I'm up there, I've got the money's perception. You don't have the money's, maybe not true.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. But now application is mm. whereby now, like for example, let me give a car that is abused beyond, just because it has some shelf strength, Probox.
Mm.
It has turned into a truck, it has turned into a pickup, it has turned into everything.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. So when accidents happen, you go like, what happened? But was the application correct? Not too sure.
Was that what you meant with your question?
No. He's turned around the question and he's answering his own question. That's not what I asked.
Ask the question again.
What we try to do when selling and marketing cars,
yes.
is to understand what the customer wants the car for.
Mm.
Yeah. And we try to match your needs vis-a-vis what we have. And that's why at Ektar we notice that not everybody has Subaru is the answer to what they need. So we brought in JC. That offers versatility.
Mm.
So you can give you a double cab pickup rather than give you a legacy to go to your farm. So I have a double cab for you that is four-wheel drive that can take you there. So we are trying to make sure that we are able to provide to the needs of the customer. Of course, there'll be resistance.
You know, you brought in an interesting perspective because I've seen car manufacturers that were known to provide SUVs and saloon cars.
Mm-hmm.
They offer pickups now.
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't you guys offering pickups?
Subaru pickup.
Yes.
Ndaka Subaru pickup.
No, I'm asking the question because some of those vehicles
double cab.
Even previously didn't have lorries.
Mm.
They now have lorries.
Mm-hmm.
So you first look and you say lorry.
Mm-hmm.
There were some car manufacturers who were known to manufacture lorries.
Yes.
And then manufacture some really tiny looking cars.
Mm-hmm.
But that is what they were known for.
Yes.
Now, I'm simply asking, if you have a popular brand,
mm-hmm.
are you saying you wouldn't have someone who would probably like to buy that brand but a different version of the car?
That would definitely be there. But now that goes back to the manufacturer. Where does he want to position himself?
Yeah.
It's called positioning.
Positioning.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, where does he want to position himself?
Mm.
So you'll find that some manufacturers will provide right from a tuk-tuk all the way yes. to an 18-wheeler.
Yes.
Some will play safe or play a niche and say, I want to play in this segment, just like Subaru. Subaru offers compact SUV, period. That's where the Subaru plays.
Compact SUV.
Yeah. So for us now, as a dealer here, we said Kenyans need more than that. So what do I do? So I bring in JC to make sure that I'm able to fulfill what the market wants.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why the word compact?
Compact, there are several sizes of SUV. There's compact SUV, there's a huge one, so there are different varieties.
Please explain to me so that I understand compact, huge. Because there are some SUVs which are fairly small.
They are fairly small.
Yes.
Compact SUV, yeah, I would call it the class around what you have, the Forester is having, the Honda CR-V, the RAV4s, and all that is a compact SUV.
They are compact. Why are they called compact?
Because they are not too big and not too small. They sit somewhere right in the middle.
Okay.
Yeah, of where functionality is.
Okay.
They have off-road capability, but not to the level of a Land Cruiser, so to speak.
Mm.
Are you sure?
Absolutely. Yeah. So it depends on why.
Is the capability better or less?
No, application. So I'm saying if you're going proper off-road and mountaineering and all that, maybe you'll need a Nissan Patrol, a Land Cruiser, or something bigger.
Okay.
So that you have a big ground clearance, you've got bigger tires, you've got bigger torque and everything else. Okay. And you're able to lock diffs, which some of the small SUVs or the compact SUVs are able to do.
Mm.
You can have all-wheel drive, but you're not able to lock diffs, as it were. So you find the proper off-road SUVs have all those extra capability, which right. also double cabs have.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Is Oriel available across the country, or is it only in Nairobi?
Okay. Oriel, as a company, we have three branches. We have Nairobi as headquarters, we have one in Mombasa, and one in Kisumu. And in regions where Oriel is not available, because we know we attend to several fleet owners like lease companies and several corporates. So wherever we don't have any of our outlets, we have the so-called dealers that form our network.
Mm.
So, like for example, in Nakuru we have a dealer, Eldoret we have a dealer. You go to places like Narok, Kisii, Bungoma, Kakamega, we are all over.
Mm.
But our main offices as Oriel is in Mombasa, Nairobi, and Kisumu. In Nairobi, we have three outlets, one along Mombasa Road, one in Ngong Road, and one in Ojijo Road, Parklands.
Those guys that I'd find at an Oriel station, are they mechanics or are they attendants?
Or are the attendants mechanics?
We call them technicians.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
What's the difference?
The difference between technician and
a mechanic.
And a mechanic.
Mm.
Technicians, basically what we do as Oriel is suspension. Mm. We don't open engines.
Mm.
We don't work on bodyworks. We are just into service and suspension parts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So most of our guys, we train them as technicians just to handle those light duties that go with suspension system.
Okay.
Yeah.
But do they have, how much is this training? How much of understanding of a motor vehicle and its operations do they have? Apart from just looking and seeing, boss, you know, I rubber.
We've got a lot of technical training institutes in the country that we recruit from. Then we scale up with in-house training to let them appreciate the products that we sell. So first of all, product training. Oriel does aftermarket parts. So what Oriel sells is all brands, not just Subaru. We service all brands. So they understand the application of what shock will work with which car, what bush fits in what, and what springs fit in what, and how do you test the elasticity of all those things in place. So after the normal training in our technical institutes, then now we bring them in-house and does training specific to the products that we sell and the applications.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the motor show that we'll be participating in this weekend. Mm-hmm. What should you expect to see when you come to the ECTA stand?
In the ECTA stand, we'll have Subarus, Outback and Forester, and Crosstrek. We have three brands that we currently sell in this country, with different levels of each. Then we also have JC, Jack, of which we have the electric double cab, electric trucks, but we also have diesel versions of the same as well.
Mm.
And then we'll also have our suspension specialists. The Oriel team will also be there as well to explain about suspension and applications and where we can be able to service you.
I see. Yeah.
And then we'll also display parts in terms of Subaru and JC as well, and where within our network you can access the same.
Okay.
Thank you.
So someone can even come there and make an order. Right, make a reservation to visit an Oriel at a later date.
Absolutely.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So, where will it be? Tell people where the motor show is going to be.
Sarit.
It's at Sarit. Your city,
yes.
Right? So, Andrew Omolo is the Group Sales and Marketing Manager at ECTA. The dealers in the country of Subaru, of the JAC or Jack Electric Mobility Vehicle, pickups and trucks, and also Oriel. Charles Alo is the Oriel Ngong Road branch manager. He knows 75 things about suspension. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being with us. Keep it here for more conversations.
This is the Situation Room, the only way to start your day.